Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
We'll extend the last topic we are covering is in situ stress and displacement measurements. So quickly, I will cover the overcoring techniques today. Flat jack we have already covered. So quickly, we will go through overcoring techniques and hydrofracturing techniques. I want to give the very basic flat jack we did in details. Overcoring concept is also very beautiful. And once you will see how the people have applied the concept to find out the in situ stress and this flat jack. Okay. So quickly, I will go through this page. And so here the overcoring technique. There is the second method, which is based on certain principle that is called a stress relieving method. Okay, or overcoring technique. So this is the method by which we can measure the stresses. And there are three methods which have been developed in this category. That is called USBM type borehole deformation gauge. Second is CSIR or CSIRO type cell with 9 or 12 strain gauge. And third is Bori probe. USBM is a regulatory as well as the scientific body located in US. So that is United States Bureau of Mines. Now this is no longer exist. This USBM has been replaced by another agency that is known as NIOSH, N-I-O-S-H. Okay. So, and second is your CSIR or CSIRO. That is stands for Commonwealth Scientific and Industrial Research, or Commonwealth Scientific Industrial Research Organization, right? And third is your Bori probe. And a strain gauge. Many of you have not known about this strain gauge. Possibly we will talk about this strain gauge in coming classes. So that is a part of instrumentation which we are using in rock mechanics or other engineering disciplines also to measure the strain in the body. And there is another instrument which we are introducing in today's class that is called deformation gauge, means we are trying to find out the deformation in the body. Okay, so one is the measurement of deformation in USBM type borehole. Another is your called a strain in CSIRO type cells. Okay, so which we will see. Okay, so I will go just very quick as far as the method is concerned. So something is written over here, and there is certain procedures are there which we have to follow for to measure the stress based on this method. And why I'm talking about this deformation or the strain, why we are measuring this? Because in flat jack method, you have seen, we have measured the stress directly. We have not talked about anything about deformation or the strain at all, right? Or the material property, right? So, but here in this overcoring techniques, we'll talk about deformation and strain, right? Why? Because in this method, we will first measure this deformation and then we will convert this deformation into stresses by our stress-strain relationships. Maybe the Hooke's law we will use to find out the stresses in this method. So this method will be indirect to measure the stresses. And in first method, we will measure deformation. And in next method, we will measure the strain. In third method also, we will measure the strain, right? So this will be a method which will be more comprehensive. More This method will be more comprehensive comparison to the flatjack method, right? So this will be more comprehensive, which we'll see, right? So because we are measuring more parameters in this case in this method rather than flatjack method. That's why when I was talking about the flatjack technique, I told you that method is very very simple. And that's why still we are using that technique to get an idea about the stress at a point. Whether that is stress, because that stress will be induced stress, it is not measuring a in situ stress. So with that method, we are measuring the stresses, that is induced stress. And that idea we will get it. And because that is a very simple one. When we are, in this method, we have to make as one of the limitation which we have seen in flatjack technique was that we have to make a hole, we have to make a slot just at the surface of the rock, okay. So that time I told you that because it is right at the surface, so we are not measuring the in situ stress because at that point of time, I will go back to one figure I had mentioned in last class. Like if you have a circular tunnel and I will make a slot at this location, this blue colored rectangle, and I will start measuring the stress at this location. So what will happen? We are going to measure the induced stress. Okay. So the suggestion which was given in this overcoring technique was okay, let us have a measurement something far away from this main large opening, and we can reach up to this location by creating a hole. We will create a borehole right at from the opening to this location. Maybe that hole will be very very small, maybe 76 mm. This is what ISRM has recommended for the diameter of the hole. So this diameter of the hole will be very very small, and we can make a drill a hole from this end and reach up to the surface, up to this location. Okay, and then we can have a small hole that we will call it a pilot hole, which will be created at this location. Okay, if I can reconstruct this figure itself so that you can have a better idea, and I will try to maybe somewhere in the vertical size itself. So I will make a larger hole from the surface, large bore hole, maybe 20-25 meters away. And then at the end, I am creating a smaller diameter hole. That is smaller diameter, as far as our recommendation is concerned, that can be of 38 mm. Okay, so we are creating a larger diameter hole, and then we are creating a smaller diameter hole. And this will be the distance. This will be the distance what we are trying to keep it away. Our aim is that we want the point of measurement to be far away from this place. Okay, this far away, maybe a few meters, maybe a few hundred meters, maybe D meter. I'm putting it D, some D. Okay, some L. So this L can be anything. Okay, as far as our recommendations are concerned, it can be a few meters, few hundred meters, no? Maybe in the range of double digits, up to 80, 90 meters, people have done it with this method, okay? So we have a distance from the hole itself. If it is a rectangular opening, we can make a small hole. Maybe I can put a rectangular opening here. And in the rectangular opening itself, you can have this type of a hole. You can have this type of hole on the sidewall, and it will go far away. And we want this diameter of this hole to be as less as possible so that the effect of induced stress will be less. Okay, we want that distance to be the diameter of these holes, bore holes, to be as less as possible. Okay, this is what our aim is. Our aim is to keep this to be as less as possible. Okay. So like this, if a rectangular opening is there, we can keep it okay, something like this. So this will be the situation. If a rectangular opening is there, we can make a hole, and at the end we will make a small hole. Okay, so this will be this way. If circular opening is there, we can make a drill hole, and then after we have a smaller hole. So we want this hole to be as small as possible, and that will depend upon the type of instrument we have, the size of the instrument we have, right? So here we are talking about a size which is similar to your pen. Our instrument which we are using, the diameter of instrument will be similar to the pen we are holding, right? So the people are working, the scientists are working to make it as small as possible so that the effect, whatever we are getting at this location, induced stress, can minimize it as less as possible, okay? So as far as the far field is concerned, this is okay, fine. But the diameter, what we are using here, it is about almost 38 mm. It is 3.8 centimeter, right? So 3.8 centimeter hole will be this small hole that is called the pilot hole will be drilled at the end. Now I will come to the method. So this is the instrument we have. Now it is like a pen. Okay, the diameter will be a little more. This diameter is about 38 mm. Okay, and you can find that at the periphery of these holes there is a pin. Pin is there. These pins are almost 60 degree apart, not almost, these are 60 degree apart. So in a 360 degree orientation, there will be six such pins will be there. And these pins can deform once they can move up and down, they can move diametrically. Actually, they can move diametrically. And with this movement, they can measure the deformation in the rock walls. So if you are keeping six such pins around the periphery, what will happen? Two such pins will be opposite to each other, right? Diametrically opposite to each other. Two such pins will be diametrically opposite to each other. So if our diameter is D, if diameter of the hole is D, if D means 38 mm, and these pins are kept apart, so whatever the deformation we are measuring across that diameter, so that deformation divided by the original diameter of the hole is going to give you the strain. So this is the concept here. So we are measuring the deformation of the borehole across the diameter at three different locations, because there are six pins are there, and two of them are just opposite, diagonal opposite to each other. So they are measuring the deformation across the diameter, right? So if you see this figure, if you can see this photograph, in this figure, this firm line is showing you the original circumference of the circle, which we have made. And this dotted line is showing you once the deformation of the hole will took place, right? And why this deformation will took place, I will explain you. But once this deformation in the hole will took place, we can measure this deformation with these pins, which will be diagonally opposed. This arrowhead is showing you the direction of the pin, and we can measure this deformation across this diameter. Is it okay? So now, if I will quickly go to the method. So method I can explain with this this simple figure. And as I told you, we will make a bigger holes. We'll make a bigger holes, and there will be a certain requirements of these instruments are there because this should not vibrate, this should make the hole in a linear direction, in a particular direction, they should not deviate from their direction. So those requirements are there. I am not going into those things, but I will tell you the how we are going to measure it. What is the principle behind this overpouring techniques to measure the in-situ stress, right? So now in the figure, first figure, you will see I am creating a bigger hole with the drilling instrument, the instrument which is used to make this hole is you call the drilling instrument. You will go through your DMD classes. Drilling chapters will be covered. And we will cover a larger diameter hole. And after that, once we will reach up to a certain depth, and the requirement is that because we can collect a core, the rock pieces we will collect from these holes. And we want these rock pieces to be continuous in nature, right? Because when we are applying, when we are converting this displacement into a stresses, only one method which we are using, that the material is elastic in nature. And once we are assuming that the material is elastic in nature, we want that the rock should be free from any discontinuities, right? So our location should be free from any such type of discontinuities. Then only our calculation of stress will be it will be accurate, right? So now you see, when I am starting a drilling into the rock mass, you will see from all the sides, stresses, in situ stresses will be there, right? And once this, we are drilling into an in situ stress field, we want this wall to be stable. And so that we are putting some stabilizers, right? So that they can, they will allow this wall to be stable to complete these operations, right? Once we will complete a larger diameter hole, then we will go for a smaller diameter hole, okay? And once we are going to a smaller diameter hole, what will happen? The stress, already this is under stress. Huh? So you can see the stress directions. It is just perpendicular to the direction of drill hole, right? So once we are applying this in situ stress is there. And once we are creating this and we are leaving our deformation gauge over here. The instrument I have shown you, we are kept it at this place for about 2 days time, maybe 48 hours. We will keep it over here. And what will happen? Because this hole we have already created, and once this hole is already created and the stress is already there, what will occur? This hole is going to subside or it will collapse. Some deformation will be monitored, will happen during that period. So what will happen once this hole is done, we will put the instrument over here and we will allow this instrument to measure those deformations. So this, all the loads, all deformation loads. So we are not allowing these instrument to resist the movement of the rock at all. We are not allowing this instrument to resist the movement like what the stabilizer is doing over here. We are just allowing this load or this deformation to be transferred on the pins which is connected with the borehole deformation gauge. Okay, so deformation gauge is just receiving the deformation of the rock walls. Nothing else. It is not resisting any deformation further, right? That is very, very flexible. And if you are if you have a pen, that pen, we have a lever at the end so that we can make our pen on and off. So it is something like that. So once the rock is under contact with this pin, so deformation will be recorded in our instrument directly, right? So once this is being done and happened for a long time, it is being connected with a wire. Number of wires, maybe six such deformation gauges are there. So see, six different cables will go outside the well with the borehole, and we can measure these deformation of different pins at different locations. We can mark it, and we can measure this deformation for all the pins, right? So once this is done, once this is there for about 48 hours, what we will do? We will now go for removing this this one, what is called deformation gauge. How we are doing? How we are removing? We are just over coring it. We are coring this entire rock by larger diameter bit. And this entire core will be recovered from here. So once we are coring this, what will happen? The stress which was transferring from one end to the another end. Okay. Now what will happen? It is going to have a shift in this direction, because always I told you, this is now not going, no longer is going to be an in situ stress. It is going to be a induced stress at this corner, right? So it will just passing along the damage, the periphery of the circular hole, right? So we will take this entire core out of the rock. Okay, so how it will look like? One figure if you'll see, it will be something like this. This is like an overcore we are receiving from the from below the surface. So this is a small hole, and you can see this is the larger hole. Okay, larger hole. So diameter, this is 38 mm diameter, and this is about 96 mm diameter, right? So this is the overcoring, and the instrument will be lying inside this hole. Like in this figure, figure you will see, this is this one is your rock core, and the instrument is lying inside it. Okay, so this is all about. So what is happening? In one instance, what we are doing over here, we are keeping our instrument in a stress field. We are keeping our instrument in a stress field like this second figure. And under this stress field, whatever the deformation is happening to the rock material is being monitored by the instrument. Okay. And after that, we are relieving the stress. Means we are relieving this stress deformation grace from this in situ stresses by just overcoring. Means that so that's why the overcoring name has been given to it, because we are taking this already a annular core with another bigger holes, and that's why this name of overcoring has given to this method. And another thing is that we are relieving this stress at this point of time when we are just overcoring the rock. That is the time when we are relieving the stresses. So that's why this method is known as overcoring techniques or relieving methods, right? A stress relieving method. So during this process, what will happen? Your deformation of these two pins are going to be started with the lowest value, means zero, means this diameter will be the actual diameter. And after that, these two points are going to closer with each other. Na? Diametrically, these two points is coming closer to each other. So this is what we are going to measure it. If you look at the actual measurement data, if you can see this graph, this is what it is. Initially, the distance between the pins are, we are keeping to be equal to diameter, or we are reset it to a zero value, right? So we are measuring the deformation even of that diameter, whether that deformation is a positive. If it is moving towards each other, we are taking it as a positive deformation. If it is going away from each other, we are taking it as a negative deformation. So this can be possible here, right? And we are measuring, you can see the depth of overcoring bit. In x-axis, it is mentioned the depth of overcoring bit. Okay. So overcoring depth here, it is 0 to 500 mm, means 0 to 50, means up to half meter, right? So 0 to half meter, we have a overcoring is happening. And your point of measurement is somewhere here. Your point of measurement is somewhere here, right? So we are finding that as the diametrical deformation. So the diametrical deformation is 0. And as the time passes, the deformation is also keeps on changing. Somewhere it is, so in some direction it is less, some direction it is more, and some of the directions it is far more than the others. So it means that in all the directions, the deformation is also is not same. If you are working at a greater depth, the deformation in the three directions are not same. If it is same, this is isotropic condition. If it is not same, it is an anisotropic condition. It means that in all the locations, we have the different values of stresses. Okay. So we can measure these stresses in, we can measure the deformation in three different orientations, right? And what is our aim? Now, once we have measured this deformation, we have to find out the strain. So simply, what will be the strain? So simple strain will be like in this figure. In this figure, you can see if the diameter of the hole is D. So we can find out if one of the pin is measuring U1 by 2. So that is complete deformation will be U1. So the strain will be U1 divided by D. Similarly, for the second pin and fifth pin, this will be U3. Something, this is U3. So this will be U3 divided by D, right? Similarly, for this direction, U1 divided by D. So this is the strain we are measuring at three different orientations. Okay. Because this instrument is fixed in a particular orient, because all these pins are fixed in a particular location, right? All the pins are fixed at a particular location. So if we can know the direction of any of the pin in our coordinate system, XY coordinate system, as we have defined, and if you can find that the angle between the our coordinate system and the pin direction, if something is defined, some theta is there, so we can find it out what is the direction of each of the pin in that particular plane. Because this pin, if you can pass it a plane which is passing through all the six pins, so we can find a nice plane will be there. A plane we can define which is passing through all these six pins, right? So if you can define a line or a direction in which it is inclined at an angle something theta, so we can find out the orientation of each of the pin in our coordinate system. So that is not a difficult task, because we know the angle between the two pins. So in a particular plane, if we know if we have the three measurements, if we have a three measurement of a strain, or corresponding, we can find out the three stresses in that particular direction. Three stresses in that particular direction. So as the calculation we did in case of flat jack technique, we can find out our principal stress directions out of it. Okay, which one is the principal stress directions? Because here again, we are measuring the normal deformation. No shear deformations we are measuring. So based on these three measurements of deformation, we can find out the stresses, and we can find out the strain. First of all, we are getting the deformation. Deformation is being converted into a strain. And then a strain is being converted into a stress. To convert a stress, a strain into a stress, we need to have a material property, right? And because this is happening in a three-dimensional plane, it is happening in a two-dimensional plane. So we have to have the modulus of elasticity, and we have to determine the Poisson's ratio. If you want to use the Hooke's law, we need to have this modulus of elasticity and Poisson's ratio. And for that, we have a very good instrument that is called we can call it a biaxial test apparatus. The apparatus I have introduced you earlier. So we can use this biaxial test apparatus to find out the modulus of the rock, or the Poisson's ratio of the rock or the sample, whatever we have created, overcore sample in our laboratory, right? So what is the shape and size of this biaxial test apparatus is? Like in this figure, you'll see it is very, very clearly shown. A cylinder is there, and having a inner surface is very, very flexible in nature, which is like something like a flat jack type of system is there. And we will insert this instrument, this overcore, into this shell, and we are applying a hydraulic pressure across this cell, okay, in this biaxial cell. And once we are applying the pressure, the lot of pressure will be applied on this rock, and the instrument is still connected with the instrument. Our deformation gauge is still connected with the instrument. So we are applying some pressure, and we are measuring the deformation, right? we are applying some pressure and we are measuring a deformation. So we can develop a nice stress strain curve. We can develop a stress strain curve for this activity also. We can develop, have a stress. We can have the strain curve for this also. Okay, so once we are getting this stress strain curve, so we'll find out what we will find out. We will find out the modulus. We have the stress strain curve, we will get some, it will be not truly linear, but it will be non-linear in wave, and we can have we can have the stress on the vertical or maybe the load on the vertical axis and the deformation in the x-axis, or the strain in the x-axis. So we can get the slope of this curve, and that is going to give you the modulus, right? Similarly, we can find out the, because we are measuring this deformation in a three-dimensional field, no? Because the stress is acting from all the sides. No? It is acting from x-axis as well as the y-axis. So we can use those data to find out the strain, or the Poisson's ratio also. So this is going to give us the modulus and the Poisson's ratio once by using this biaxial test chamber, right? So this load is being applied with this pump pressure, this hydraulic pump, in a monotonically increasing way, and this curve will also be like that. Yeah? So this is a very good way of measuring this deformation, and it is being converted into stresses, and the stress we are getting the material properties, right? So what we are looking so far that this method. So this is what a pictorial representation over here. Some of the conditions which is needed is that this overcoring hole should be more than. So this is the length of the core we want to take out. So this is some of the application, or when we are using this instrument for the removal of the core, some of the application is there, some of the conditions are required for the operation also. So that part I am not going into that. But I think it is it will be clear to you that once we are making this type of hose, how easily we can measure the stresses. So here we are just using the deformation gauge, and with the deformation gauge we are measuring the stresses. So we have from the theory of elasticity, we have developed some relationships also, and based on these relationships we can find out what will be the stresses, the principal stresses in that particular plane, right? So based on the theory of elasticity, we can find out these values, okay? We have also developed the equations for the modulus of elasticity. We can use this d is the diameter, and the d, small d, is the smaller diameter. And this is the pressure which is being applied on the body. And we have this deformation, okay? So with this, we can find out the total modulus. What is the modulus of this one? Okay, so that can be used in this relationship to find out the principal stress, and with this formula we can find out the direction of the principal stress. Here again we are using the principal elasticity theory to find all these values, right? So any questions at this point?
So can you please explain the overcoring part again?
Okay, this coring is known to you. Are you introduced with coring? With coring? No. So now I have a video. I think I had also shared this video to all of you. Possibly some of you might have seen that video. So just look at this. This video is very nice, and I have taken it from one company website. See, this is an example not from a actual mining operation, but from a petroleum operation, where we are using a large hole drill from the surface, right? So just have a look into this. So once we are drilling, so what is happened, this drill we have a, this is called, okay, I will come to that later on. So you see the operation first. So do not get stuck with these dimensions. Okay, so based on the applications, the people have used this diameter to be different, this diameter to be different, right? So the reference what I am using for our work is purely for the from our ISRM recommendation, that is a governing body for the development of the rock mechanics around the world. And here you will see this company has coming up with the diameter. This pallet hole diameter is 25.5 mm, which is less than what I had told you. That is, I had told you about 38 mm. They are talking about the 25 mm. Okay. So this from this part to this part, this is your pallet hole in which we are going to fit the instruments, right?
Six log. From the pollution system. Across the pins, mission devices. Or is then dropped. We failed.
Now you say this overcoring starts, right? We are taking our this rock itself without affecting the instrument which is lying over here, because that will give us information about the material characteristic, because we have to test it right at the surface. So we want that this rock, we have to take it at the surface. So what we are doing here, we have a drilling system is there, which we can, that is called, which is annular in shape. The cutting will be there, cutting at the right at the periphery, and the rock which is there inside, that will be intact. That is not going to be affected at all. So this is called your overcoring. Now you can see, you can follow this. Now as soon as we are overcoring it, we are relieving this area from the in situ stresses. So as soon as we are relieving this area from the in situ stresses, what will happen? The area which was under stress, now we are relieving it, so it will again come back to its original value if it is elastic in nature. So that's why you will see that this curve is when it was loaded with the in situ stress, and this is what the change is happening. Once we are relieving the stress, means it is now elastic in nature, so rebound to its own original dimension, right? So is it okay?
Yes.
Is it okay? Yeah, it's okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, so in your DMD classes also, you will come across with different types of drilling beads, and one drilling accessories is there that is called the core barrel. Okay, so core barrel we are using to protect these cores, so that while this mechanical rotation. The cores are not the rock, which we are trying to collect it from 1 kilometer below or 2 kilometer below the surface or maybe 100 meter below the surface. They are not getting affected by the movement at all. So there are different types of core barrels. Are there single tube core barrel, double tube core barrel, triple tube core barrel, so that we can take a lot of precautions for different types of material. If it is very, very fragile, possibly we will go for triple core barrels or the single or if it is not very hard type of rock, so we can go with the single tube core barrel also, right? So there are different techniques are there which you will study in your DMD drilling section about how to collect it and how these are going to be tested in the lab. So that was part of our laboratory test. So once the material is with you, so you can do n number of tests with that. We can, as it was mentioned, we can measure the modulus of elasticity, Poisson's ratio, density also. Now, so n number of tests you can do. But for this, as far as the overcoring technique is concerned, we need to have only two properties important to find out the stresses. That is your modulus of elasticity and Poisson's ratio. Okay. Any more questions? Any more questions?
So in that video that you showed, why does the diameter decreases while it goes down?
Oh, why? Okay. Now, if you see this figure, is it okay? This figure is clear to you?
So this which figure? Stress management.
One minute. I'm sharing the another one. Like, you can see this figure, or maybe I can draw a new figure here. Maybe if I can take a section, simple if I can take a section, because it is a circular hole, and you will find that all along the hole, we have the stresses, right? Now, at one instance, this hole is filled with material. Blue color is showing you the filled material. So, is it okay?
Yes, sir.
This figure is there. So, in situ stresses are acting, right? So, in situ stresses are acting all from all sides, right? So once this in situ stress is there and in acting all from all the sides, so what is happened? It will be under equilibrium, no? Okay, I'm talking about a hole. No, it is not a hole. This is the place where I'm trying to make a hole. Now I'm making a hole. You just see, I'm putting in no fill. Now, if I'm making a hole and the stress are already there, what will happen to this one? It will try to press the boundary of the hole, right? So this is what it is happening here. It is trying to press the boundary of the hole. Okay, and once it is going to press it, the deformation of the wall of the rock will take place. Maybe it can take any of the shape. If I can draw with some freehand, it can be of any shape. Okay. It can be of any shape. Okay. And so in this instrument, we are trying to measure this deformation of this wall. I can keep a different color so that you can get a difference. Maybe a dotted one. Okay. Now, what I'm trying to do, I'm going to measure this deformation. I do not know what will be the nature of this deformation, but I am trying to measure this deformation by putting the pins, as you have seen the pins, I'm trying to put a pins across the instrument. It is oriented with the instrument and it is maybe placed somewhere here. Okay. So this instrument are located at 60 degree apart at six different locations. And this is what we are measuring, right? Is it okay? So the deformation of the holes are happening because it is being drilled into an in situ stress. Some stress is there. If no stress will be there, no deformation. If some differential stress will be there, so differential deformation will take place. If from all the sides of your stress will be there, so your shape will remain same. So it will be some size is going to change, something like that. So we are interested to find out what will happen if this stress field is getting disturbed, and we are trying to find out their effects. So what we are trying to find out? We are trying to find out the deformation. And after that, we are converting this deformation into a stress, because we know the original dimension. How we are defining a strain? We are defining change in dimension to the original dimension. So whatever the change in dimension is taking place, so that change divided by the original length diameter is D. So that is your strain. Now we are taking out this core right at the surface, and we are measuring the modulus of elasticity and Poisson's ratio in the lab. And once we are measuring this modulus of elasticity and Poisson's ratio, that can be directly converting this strain into a stress value. This is what the procedure we are following. So by doing all this, we are converting this into your stress value. Any more questions? I think you got your answer, or still you need some clarification?
So like in the video, the diameter decreases, right? So
yeah.
So still, I'm not clear, sir. Like how?
How? So what is happening? I can, it is, Now you see, as I told you, I had given you a solid fill like this. Now, if the material is completely full, and you have a horizontal stresses. You remember horizontal stresses?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
How many horizontal stresses we have?
Two
horizontal stresses. No. So in this figure, I'm showing you one of the horizontal stresses. That is, okay. So which is shown over here, you can see. So we have two horizontal stresses. So if any force or the stress is acting on a body and they are in equilibrium, right? So it is under equilibrium. Now, once I'm making an opening, definitely I'm changing the equilibrium state of the body. Now, so whatever the material is there around this point, so what is happening? Everything will try to move into the wide space, right? Say, for example, if you have a big a pile of sand is there in around your house, and you are trying to make a scoop out of that, a small amount from somewhere in the bottom of the pile of sand. What will happen? Whatever the upper overlying sand will be there, they are trying to fill that area, the void area. So similarly, here also, this is a material property, and once we are making a void, the material which is around it, they are under a stress condition, and they are trying to move towards the wire area. Like you, if you are applying a force on some body, on some element or structure, and under the stress, both are in the static condition, and once one of them is released, one of them will try to move into the other side. No? So say, for example, this stress, which is acting from this horizontal side, this will try to move this side, this will try to move this side, this will try to move this side. So it is a natural tendency of material to move under the effect of your forces or the stresses.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir.
It is a simple. You are applying a force and something is moving, something like that. Okay, so in underground or below surface, the material is under a static condition, and we have relieved the support. So you can understand in some other way. I think I will explain you in some other class. When we are designing a support. So here, what is your support of if this boundary, the support is your in situ material, right? And we are trying to remove this in situ material. And once this support is removed, now they are the action of the unbalanced forces will act on that the boundary. Nah? So under the unbalanced force, see, so the deformation is inevitable. So we have to find out how much is the deformation, whether that deformation is within the strength of the material or whether that deformation is out of the strength of the material. Means whether the strength of the material is able to withstand that stress or not. If it is not, then the failure will happen. If it is able to withstand, means no failure is going to happen. Okay, so this will be our design principle, which we will discuss some other time. Okay, when we'll try to design something, okay, as far as the support is concerned. So to want to make it stable, what we have to do? You have to apply some counter stress across this in situ stresses. Then only you can make it stable. If you want that, I want a 5 meter diameter tunnel and want to be stable. Because I want it to be a travel path for railways or maybe for hydroelectric projects or something like that, or maybe for mining also, you want to have a tunnel of 5 meter diameter, whatsoever reason it is. So if the material of this type of deformation is possible, so what will be our purpose? The engineer will, what we will do, they will design a support so that it will try to counter these stresses. It will try to counter these stresses. Nah? So that a strength we have to determine, how much stress we can apply, just a second. So how much stress we can apply from this opening so that we can control the deformation. How much stress we can apply so that we can control this deformation. Okay, so that thing we have to study, and that is also a thing which we can design also, right? How much stress we can apply so that we can control this deformation. So in this experiment, we are trying to find out how much deformation actually happened, and the type of support we need to have designed. It will depend upon how much deformation actually happening here, right? It will all depends upon the type of deformation is being happening at this surface. Based on that, the counter resistance we will create based on our engineering support will be provided from, or man-made support will be provided from this opening so that we can control their deformation. Okay, is it okay? I think I have deviated to some other line also, maybe some few classes which will be held after maybe some classes. Or support design, we will get some idea about that. So I had gone into that. I think it's okay. Okay. Any more questions? So I think any more questions you have?
How will you find the stress that is without knowing the value of elastic modulus?
How can you tell again?
We should know the value of elastic modulus firstly, na? Then we can find the stress values.
Yeah.
And then it must be known earlier than the process, na? Because of finding stresses.
No. So as I explained you that we are measuring the deformation first, then we are collecting the rock and testing in the laboratory. Okay. So first we are preparing our deformation data before measurement of the modulus property, right? So we are collecting the deformation data first, then we are collecting the or measuring the modulus property. Okay, and if you'll compare with the flat jack technique, You will see that there is no need to find out the material property at all in case of flat jet. Okay. Yes. So we are it's okay. Any more questions? Any more questions? Okay. So I think this is all for today. Tomorrow we'll talk about some strain gauges, and the similar procedure will be there. Instead of deformation gauge, we will use strain gauges, or we can call it a strain gauge rosettes. So based on that, another instrument have been developed. So tomorrow we'll try to finish this chapter completely, right? Be ready for tomorrow and try to, if some of you, I am sure that some of you might not understand what it is. So please ready with your questions, or maybe try to post the question in our chat box, or try to see the video. Video is very nice, so you can go through that, and whatever the doubts I'm trying to cover in the class, that video is also going to help you. Okay. So thank you very much for, we'll meet tomorrow. Okay. So thank you, sir. Dr. Rakesh.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, in the previous class, you have explained about flat jack questions, no sir, which contain 5x5 matrix.
6x6 matrix.
Sir, will you please explain that once again?
Oh, so those who do not want to have another class, they can leave. Okay. So we can continue with... Okay.
And also how to find the principal stress direction, sir, in flat jack.
Okay, you can go through for finding. Okay, we have this one. No? You please go through the video, the classes I had already taken, right? In this video itself, I had discussed, we have this, okay, 3x3 matrix we are creating based on these three
samples. This one is clear, sir. This one is clear, sir.
Yeah. So, to finding these principal stresses, you can go through the solid mechanics, this sigma 1 is equal to that relationship, sigma 1 is equal to...
Yes, sir.
So, based on that, you can find out your sigma 1 and sigma 3.
But we are having 5x5 matrix, no sir. So in that case.
Yeah, you have, okay. In that case.
Three.
Yeah, this one, no? 3x5. Okay, so this your, when we are taking this five measurements, when we are doing this five measurement, so we have the five normal stresses we have, and we have a 5x3 matrix we are creating. And for that, we are taking a transpose of this, so it becomes a 3x3 matrix. Once you are taking a transpose, it becomes a 3x3 matrix. Okay.
Yes, sir.
If you'll do that, we'll get, it will be 5x3 becomes 3x3 matrix. Okay, so yes. Once you will calculate over here, R transpose R to the inverse to the R transpose, it will be a 3x3 matrix. Okay, you can use Excel sheets, na? You can use Excel sheets for this calculation, or maybe your calculator also, this options are there to get this convergence. Okay, once you will do this operation, you will get your matrix converted into 3x3 matrix.
Okay.
So in this case, we are going to find out the best fit line. No? We are trying to find out, we are using the least square method to find out the best fit line or the best fit value out of these three experiments, five experiments. Rather than in first questions, we have only three equations we have solved, and we have the three unknowns was there. But here we have five equations are there and three unknowns are there. So we are trying to fit it by least square method, and we'll get it from there.